we are discussing LED as an optical source for high speed communication. In the last lecture, we investigated the spectral characteristics of an LED and we found that the spectral characteristic depends upon the band gap of the material and the temperature at which the device is operating. So, the band gap of the material essentially decides the peak wavelength of emission, whereas the spectral width is purely decided by the temperature of the device. And we saw that LED has a fairly large spectral width. So, if you go to about 50 nanometer, the spectral width of an LED would be typically of the order of about 100 nanometer. The second aspect which we are discussing about LED is the efficiency of electrical to optical energy conversion. And in that context, we essentially define a parameter what is called the quantum efficiency. And then we saw that there are two types of quantum efficiencies one can have. One is what is called the internal quantum efficiency, and other one is the external quantum efficiency. The internal quantum efficiency essentially is related to the photon generation process. That means, if so many electron hole pairs are recombined, how many of these can give you a photon out? The ratio of that gives you what is called the internal quantum efficiency. Whereas, after the photon is generated, while capturing the photon, whatever loss takes place, that is captured by this parameter, what is called the external quantum efficiency. Then we define the important parameters for the photon generation process, which are what are called the carrier lifetime. And we saw that the carrier lifetime can be against radiative recombination process or against non-radiative recombination process. And then by simple analysis, we got the internal quantum efficiency of this device, which is given by 1 upon 1 plus tau rr upon tau nr, where tau rr is the radiative recombination lifetime, whereas tau nr is the non-radiative recombination lifetime. So, we find that if tau rr is much less than tau nr, then the internal quantum efficiency of the device is very large. And we found for typical parameters for gallium arsenide that tau rr and tau nr are more or less comparable. So, we get internal quantum efficiency which is about 50%. And we said that this number is quite large because typically when we talk about the energy conversion process, a quantum efficiency or an efficiency of energy conversion which is more than about 20-30% is considered to be a good efficiency. So, what we conclude that electrical to optical energy conversion process is a fairly efficient process because we have efficiency typically of the order of 50%. Then we started investigating the external quantum efficiency, and that is after the photon is born, through which process the photon goes till it reaches to the finally the optical fiber, and what are the losses which the photon incurs while having this journey from the generation point to the optical fiber. And we found that if we take a very simple model, and if you assume that the photon was born somewhere deep inside the material here, that as soon as the photon is born, it is scattered. So, with equal probability, the photon can move in all directions. So, essentially the emission of photon from the location where it is born is isotropic. And then we found that essentially those photons which are lying within the critical angle, they can escape from this device, and all the photons which are born therefore cannot come out of the device. A large number of these photons get buried back inside the junction, and that is what contributes to the external quantum efficiency. So, first parameter which we saw is because of the critical angle. Let us do that analysis little more correctly. So, let us say we have a semiconducting material here, and the photon is born at this point. So we saw that those photons which lie within the critical angle cone, which is this, so this angle is theta c. So the photon which comes normal to this will escape in that direction, but the photon which goes along this path essentially will go tangential to the surface, and the photon which are traveling in between angles, they essentially go in different directions. So now we can ask a question: if n photons were born at this location, then how many photons would finally come out through this solid angle which have this half cone angle of theta c? So one can do a simple calculation. So let us say the n photon are born at this location and they are going isotropically, whereas the photon which are collected are through this solid angle. Therefore the external quantum efficiency eta external, and let us call it is external 1, that will be equal to the solid angle of this cone divided by the total solid angle over which the photons are going, that is 4 pi. So this one is circular spot which you are going to get on the surface of the device. So the solid angle for this can be written as 2 pi 0 to theta c sin theta d theta divided by the total solid angle over which the photons are traveling, that is equal to 4 pi. We can write this, so these 2 pi will cancel with this, so you have 1 upon 2. You can integrate this quantity, so that is minus cos of theta with limits 0 to theta c, which is equal to half to 1 minus cos theta c. Now if the refractive index of this material, as we said, is ns and the refractive index of this material is na, then the critical angle theta c is given as sine inverse of na by ns. So we have sine of theta c which is equal to na by ns. This gives cos theta c will be equal to square root of 1 minus sin square theta c. Now since the theta c angle is small, sin square theta c is a small quantity, so we can make a small approximation. So we say this is approximately equal to 1 minus 1 upon 2 sin square theta c, which gives cos of theta c approximately equal to 1 minus 1 upon 2 into this quantity here, sin square theta c, which is na upon n square. So you have n a square upon n s square. We can take this quantity and substitute into this expression here, and then we get the external quantum efficiency eta ext1, that is half into 1 minus this quantity here, cos of theta c, which is this. So 1 minus 1 minus 1 upon 2 n a square upon n s square. So you get the external quantum efficiency because of this total internal reflection of the photons inside the device, that is 1 upon 4 to n a square divided by n a square. Now, if you substitute the numbers for gallium arsenide, so ns for gallium arsenide is about 3.6, and let us say the photons are coming out in air, so na is equal to 1. So, let us say in this device here we have material which is gallium arsenide, so ns is equal to 3.6, and here is air, so na is equal to 1. So, if I substitute these numbers inside this expression here, we get that is equal to 1 upon 4 into 3.6 whole square, which is approximately 0.0193, or that is about 1.93%. So, as we saw yesterday, we mentioned that when the photon tries to come out, a large number of photons essentially get buried back inside the device. And now, with this accurate calculation, we see that about 2% of the photon essentially can escape from this device. That means 98% of the photons which are born are buried back inside the device itself. So, you see there is a substantial loss of photons which takes place right at the location where they are born. Now, the photons which are traveling inside this cone of critical angle, would all the photons be coming out of this junction? Now, we can use the photon as a packet of light, or we say that now the photon is a wave. So, there is an electromagnetic wave which is trying to escape this region, and there is a change in the refractive index from this medium to this medium. So, there is going to be a partial reflection of the electromagnetic wave. So, we say that even those photons which are within this angle or within the cone of this critical angle cannot escape. There will be partial reflections of the photon, and the reflection coefficient will depend upon the refractive index of this material and refractive index of this material. So, we say that because of partial reflection of the photons, all photons which are even lying within the critical angle cone cannot escape the junction. So, just for simplicity, let us assume that the photons which are now coming out, they are traveling almost normal to this interface. So, we say that this is my junction, and the photons essentially are traveling in this direction. Here we have refractive index ns, and here the refractive index is na. Then the reflection coefficient for this, power reflection coefficient, can be written as ns minus na divided by ns plus na whole square. And therefore, the transmission coefficient will be 1 minus this quantity. So, we get the transmission coefficient that is called tau trans, that is equal to 1 minus gamma. So, that is equal to 4 into Na into Ns divided by Ns plus Na whole square. Now, this quantity is nothing but again the external quantum efficiency against this process of partial reflection. So, let us call this quantum efficiency as eta external 2. So, that will be equal to this quantity here. And now, if I substitute the numbers again for the gallium arsenide, you get here this is 4 into 3.6 divided by 3.6 plus 1 whole square, and that will be approximately 0.68. Now, while traveling from this location to this location, again there would be absorption of the photons, because some of the photon may get reabsorbed inside the material. So, you may have some loss of photons even during the propagation over this distance. So, in addition to this loss and this loss, there would be some loss due to the intrinsic absorption into the material. So, we have some efficiency factor associated with absorption, let us call it eta external 3, that is due to absorption in the material. So, if we are talking only about the efficiency, external quantum efficiency from the generation of the photon to the escape of the photon, then external quantum efficiency essentially would be the product of eta ext 1 into eta external 2 and eta external 3. However, if you are saying that the quantum efficiency is defined by the availability of the photon inside the optical fiber for communication, then we have to add one more factor, that is the photon which are coming out, how many photons of that will get guided inside the optical fiber when a fiber is put inside or in front of this device. So, the question we are asking is that if this was the optical source from which the photons are coming, and if I take an optical fiber and put in front of it, how many photons finally will get guided from the device to the optical fiber. Now, without worrying about the area and compatibility, let us say the area is matched with the device. So, it is just a matter of angle through which the photons are coming. So, we are asking the total photons which are emitting from this device, how many of them would finally be guided inside the optical fiber? And as we have seen, only those light rays get guided inside the optical fiber which lie within the cone of numerical aperture. So, what we are saying now is that we have a cone of numerical aperture for optical fiber. Only if the photon is incident within this cone, then only it will finally get guided inside the fiber. Those photons which are coming at an angle greater than this, they will be again lost because they will not be guided inside the optical fiber. Now, let us point out again here that when we are talking about the critical angle inside this junction, only those photons which are lying within this theta c are escaping. But let us not have a wrong impression that when the photons are coming out, they will have a cone which is theta c. Because as I mentioned, the photon which is traveling perpendicular to this will go in this direction, whereas photon which is traveling in this direction will be along the surface. That means, if I see externally the cone over which the photons are emitted, it is essentially 180 degrees cone. So, you are having a complete hemispherical emission which is coming from LED. So, LED is not a directional device. So, whatever the photons are emitted into this cone, when they come out, essentially they come out over this 2 pi solid angle. So, we are having the emission of the photon which is isotropic as far as this half is concerned, and only from that isotropic incoming radiation that radiation which is incident within this cone of numerical aperture will get guided inside the optical fiber. So as we know that maximum angle which the fiber can accept, theta max, that is approximately given as numerical aperture. So we have theta max, which is approximately the numerical aperture. Again, assuming circular symmetry here, the solid angle of this numerical aperture would be 2 pi into an a square solid angle. So the efficiency of photon reception by the optical fiber is this solid angle divided by the solid angle of the radiated photon, which is equal to 2 pi. So we can have now eta external 4, which is equal to 2 pi into numerical aperture square divided by 2 pi, that is the solid angle of the radiating photon. So that is equal to an a square. Now if you take a typical fiber, the numerical aperture lies between 0.2 to 0.3. So a typical range of numerical aperture is 0.2 to 0.3. That means this quantity here, eta external 4, that would lie somewhere between 0.04 to about 0.09. So now if I put all the things together and then ask what is the total efficiency which I have got from the photon generation to the photon guidance inside the optical fiber, we get total external quantum efficiency eta external, that is equal to eta external 1 into eta external 2 into eta external 3 into eta external 4. So if I put all these factors, this is 0.0193 into 0.68. Eta external 3, which is because of the absorption, let us take some number for that, let us say 0.7 or 0.8, and this quantity here which we have got, which is Na square, so let us take the best possible value for that, which is 0.09. If we do this multiplication, this quantity will be approximately 10 to the power minus 3. What that means is that if 1000 photons were born, effectively one photon becomes available finally for communication. And as you saw, if you put the internal quantum efficiency on top of this, which is about 50%, it is about 2000 electron hole pairs. When they recombine, one photon becomes available for optical communication inside the optical fiber. So we see that this process is an extremely inefficient process, because we have seen that the electron hole pair essentially are proportional to the current which is injected into the device. So we have to inject so many carriers to get a very little light coming out of this. So one important conclusion which we have got about the light emitting diode, and that is, it is an extremely inefficient device, because although the photon generation process is very efficient, the photon collection makes it difficult to make a photon available for optical communication. So, now we see that the LED essentially has two problems. One is, it has a very large spectral width, that means it cannot support high data rates, and secondly, it has extremely low efficiency, that means it cannot give you a very high power. In other words, the LED cannot be used for a long distance communication, because the long distance communication requires both. It requires low spectral width so that dispersion is low, at the same time the power should be high so that signal can travel over long distance. So, at this point essentially we conclude that LED is a good device for short distance communication, and it has problem if the device has to be used for long distance communication. However, we will see that the LED has a very nice feature, and that is, LED is a fairly linear device. What that means is as follows, that if I take the LED, for every recombination which takes place, you get a photon out. Again, after putting all these efficiency factors, there is a reduction in number of photons, but still the final number of photons which are going to come out or which are going to become available for communication, that is proportional to the number of carriers injected inside the p-n junction. Or in other words, we are having the number of photons emitted by LED proportional to the current which is injected in the p-n junction. Now, the current which is going inside the junction is the rate of injection of the carriers. So, the photon which are going to come out will be the photons per unit time, or the rate of photon emission. If I multiply by the energy of the photon, we get the energy per unit time, which is nothing but power, optical power. So, what we find is that for an LED, we are having a proportionality between the optical power and the injected current in the LED. So, we get a proportionality which is optical power is proportional to the LED current. So, if I plot what is called the output characteristic of this device, this is the current which is injected inside the p-n junction, and this is the optical power. We get a linear characteristic. The slope of this will depend upon your efficiency and all the constants and so on. But the important thing is that the output which is optical power here to the input which is the current, there is a linear relationship. And therefore, this device can be used for analog kind of modulation, because in analog modulation, we require a device which is linear. And then one can get a very simple circuit. We are having now this LED. Here you can bias this LED with some DC voltage, and then you can put a small AC signal. You can get a light here which will be emitted by LED. Since this is proportional to the current which is flowing into this, you will get the AC light out here which will be proportional to this voltage which is applied. So, essentially just by changing the current inside the LED, we can generate the light output, and see there is a proportionality between these two. Essentially all the characteristics of the current temporal characteristics are transferred to the optical flux. So, optical light also will fluctuate exactly same way as the current is going to fluctuate. So, that essentially says now that using LED, just by changing the voltage which is applied across this or the current which is injected inside the device, we can change the optical power, or essentially the light can be modulated by modulating the current. So, the modulation process now is very straightforward process, that you put a AC source in series with the biasing source for the LED, and whatever modulation is there on this AC source, essentially it will get transferred to the optical signal. However, one can do a little deeper investigation to find out at what rate the modulation can be carried out. Or phrasing the question in a different way, if I increase the frequency of modulation, what will happen to the fluctuation of light? Would my LED be able to respond to the fast fluctuation which are there in the current? Now, this can be answered in two different ways. One is from the circuit point of view, that since LED is a junction, you are having a junction capacitance there, it has a resistance. So, you are having a RC time constant associated with this device. So, once you are having RC time constant, approximately 1 upon that time constant is the highest rate at which the device can operate. That is the bandwidth of the device. Other way of looking at this is that once the carriers are injected inside the depletion region, the carriers are going to remain there till they are recombined. And as we saw, there is a characteristic time, what is called the recombination lifetime of the carriers. That means, once the carriers are ejected, on average, the carriers are going to remain in that region over that lifetime. So, even if the current is switched off, the carriers are not going to disappear instantaneously in the region, but they will disappear only after a time, which is the recombination lifetime. So, one can now ask a question that even if I fluctuate the current, which is faster than the recombination lifetime, would the device respond to this current fluctuation? And the answer is no, it will not, because even if you fluctuate the current or injection of the carriers, the carrier which were injected earlier, they are still there, they have not disappeared. So, the light which is emitted will not fluctuate at the same rate. So, essentially the bandwidth of the device now will depend upon the recombination lifetime. So, let us do a very simple analysis that what is the speed of the modulation of LED, and can we change the speed or can we increase the speed of this device? So, we are essentially saying if I go for modulation of LED, then how can we manipulate the recombination lifetime of the carriers inside the junction? So, let us say we have a PN junction, and where the recombination is taking place, there are intrinsically there are carriers which are having density N0 and P0. Let us say there is a recombination constant which is R. So, rate of recombination inside the junction will be equal to this R, which is the proportionality constant, which depends upon the material, into N0 into P0. Now, because of thermal excitation, the carriers are getting generated also. So, if the device is not injected with an additional current, you are having a ambient electron density which is n0, ambient hole density which is p0, and the recombination rate which is given by this is completely balanced by the thermal emission rate. So, carriers are getting generated because of thermal excitation. So, this rate is also the thermal generation rate, because this number is not changing as a function of time in equilibrium. So, this is also equal to the thermal generation rate. Now, let us say we inject certain electrons and holes inside the p-n junction. So, the electron density is now changed from n0 to delta n, and the hole density is changed from p0 to delta p. Again, the rate of recombination will be proportional to the product of the electron density and the hole density, but now you are having a thermal generation rate also. So, some recombination is taking place, but because of thermal excitation, some electron hole pairs are getting generated. So, then we have a net recombination rate, which is the combination rate, which is equal to proportionality constant R to n0 plus delta n into p0 plus delta p minus the thermal generation rate, which is R into n0 p0, which is equal to R into n0 plus p0. And if I assume that the injected electrons and holes are equal in number, the delta n equal to delta p, we can say that this is delta n into delta n, where we have taken delta n is equal to delta p. So, now I have got a net recombination rate, and that we can write now, if I write for electrons, that is minus d delta n by dt, that is equal to R into n0 plus p0 plus delta n into delta n. Now, we can consider two cases. One is when you are having a low injection, that means the currents are low inside the p-n junction, and in that situation this quantity delta n will be much, much smaller compared to the ambient density of electrons. So, we have two cases now to consider. One is what is called the low injection case. And in this case, we have delta n, which is much, much smaller compared to n0. So, we can approximate this expression here. So, we say minus delta d delta n by dt, that will be equal to R into n0 plus p0 into delta n. So, we have minus d delta n by dt, that is equal to R into n0 plus p0 into delta n. And as we have seen earlier, this has exponential variation as a function of time, and 1 upon this quantity will be the lifetime of the carriers. So, this is the recombination lifetime. So, we have now here the tau, which will be equal to 1 upon R into n0 plus p0. This is independent of the current of current, because this current is proportional to this quantity which is delta n, and there is no delta n appearing in this. So essentially the recombination lifetime now is purely decided by the intrinsic density of electrons and holes in this, and the constant here R, which depends upon the material. Whereas on the other hand, if I take the high injection, that means the current is high, so I take delta N is much, much greater compared to N0. And in this case, then one can make an approximation that this quantity minus d delta N by dt, that will be equal to R into this quantity is negligible now. So you have delta N whole square. So you get in this case minus d delta N by dt, that is equal to R into delta N whole square. Now, as we have seen earlier, we have the recombination time defined tau, which is minus d delta N by dt divided by delta N, or this is 1 upon this, so minus 1. So, if I take from here, this quantity will be equal to 1 upon R into delta N. And since the current injected inside the junction is proportional to delta N, essentially what we find is now that the recombination time is inversely proportional to the injection current. So as the current increases, the recombination times become smaller and smaller. That means the device can be switched on or off at a much faster rate. So we have here, this is proportional to 1 upon current. So what this simple analysis tells us is that if you are operating the LED at low currents, then the speed of the LED is practically independent of the current. Whereas, if you increase the current inside the LED, then the speed of the LED can be increased because the recombination lifetime will reduce. So, the fluctuation in the light now could be faster if you are injected the LED with a high current. So that means if you want to operate the device for high speed modulation, the LED can be used with high injection current. But when you are injecting current, more current inside the device, essentially the current density is large inside the junction, and because of that the heat generation is more. So the life of the device essentially comes down. So what we find here is that if you can sacrifice some parameters like life of the device and so on, then the LED can be operated at a high speed, whereas if you operate the LED with low powers, it can operate much over much longer time, but speed will be very limited. So let us now say that suppose I wanted to modulate the LED, let us say with a digital kind of data. So I wanted to give a data which is like this, which is a pulse. So I want that when the light is emitted, it would emit a pulse which would look something like this. What one notice here, that you require a very high switching speed in this region. So essentially current has to be changed in such a way that device is switched on at a faster speed. But once the optical level is reached here, then even if the speed is low, then you don't have to worry about it because now the optical intensity reached to that level. So essentially what we are looking for is, when we are considering LED as a digital modulation device, we want that its speed should be much faster somewhere here, and even if the speed reduces over this region, it does not affect the performance. So what one can do is, one can inject high current inside the LED for a short duration so that it can switch fast, because if I inject more current, the recombination time will reduce, so device can be switched on much faster. Once we reach to this level, then essentially the current can be switched off or can be reduced and the optical intensity will stabilize. So to generate this optical pulse, essentially one can put a current which is much higher than what is required, then switch off the current, so current dies down, and then it stabilizes at this point. Same thing one can do here, to switch off the thing, one can bring it down like this. So to generate an optical pulse which is of rectangular nature here, and if the speed of this is large, then the appropriate current which should be pumped into the LED would be something of this nature. So on this edge, the current will be having an overshoot, which will essentially reduce the recombination time, or in other words, switch on the device very rapidly. Once you reach to this optical intensity, then you can reduce the current, and then the optical intensity will be constant like this. So for this current incident on the LED, this will be the optical pulse. So let us summarize now what we have seen about the LED. Starting from the semiconducting material and its properties, essentially we made a very simple device, which is nothing but a PN junction, where we inject the electrons and holes, and the electrons and holes recombine. Part of this recombination give photons out, and part of the recombination essentially produce some thermal energy which goes into heating of the junction. The photons which are generated because of this recombination, when they try to come out, many of them get buried again inside the junction. So a very small fraction of the photons come out of LED. So LED gives a very less efficiency. At the same time, because of the intrinsic nature of the semiconductor, the spectral width of LED is very large. So if we look at LED as a source from optical communication point of view, the LED essentially has two deficiencies. One is, it has a very low efficiency, and that's the reason it cannot give you high power which can travel over long distance on optical fiber. It also has very large spectral width, which is bad for dispersion because it cannot support high data rate. So LED then is a good device for small area networks. It is essentially good for local area networks. Also, since the emission which comes from LED is more or less isotropic, you require an optical fiber which has a large numerical aperture, otherwise again the efficiency becomes very small. So LED is suited essentially for multimode fiber. But good point of LED is that it has a linear relationship between the optical power and the current, and therefore this device is quite suitable for the analog kind of modulations. So what we conclude, that LED is a good device for analog modulation, but because of its other limitations, the LED can be used only over short distances, and that's why this device can be used for local area networks with multimode fibers. Whereas when we go for long distance communication, the LED is not a suitable device. And therefore, we look for other device, which is the injection laser diode, which essentially removes all the deficiencies of LEDs. So, next, when we discuss the laser diodes or injection laser diodes, essentially we have to ask the question, what way this new device is better compared to LED. So, we will discuss in the following lectures the development of injection laser diode, and every time we will compare this with the performance of the LED, and then we will see that the injection laser diode is superior compared to LED in both count. It is more efficient, and also it has a spectral width which is much smaller compared to LED.